Well, hello, God bless you, Bishop Patrick L. Wooden Sr. here, and I pray that you're having a great day. It's a beautiful day. Hey, there's a little irony going on today, though. Today is Earth Day, and you know we've heard so much about global warming and how the planet is heating up, and last few days, I've had to go and get my overcoat and my hat. Garrett had my hat last night and my coat because it was cold outside here in Raleigh, North Carolina. In some places in our state, we got down to freezing and 33 degrees in April. And there are other areas in the country where it's snowing. And so why am I bringing this up? I'm bringing this up because many of those who are pushing the global warming, climate change thing, and don't get me wrong, I believe that it is our responsibility to do everything we can to be wise stewards of God's green earth. The Bible teaches that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. Fullness literally means everything in it. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it. And so we have a responsibility to God's creation to be good citizens, to be wise, not to be litter bugs, to be just good people. But I'm not with the crowd, the tree huggers that are teaching us to worship the planet. Oh, my, people are making a religion out of climate control. And most of these people out of climate change, most of these people who are in the climate change religion have totally denounced Jesus Christ. They have no use for biblical Christianity whatsoever. But I tell you, they're trying to save the planet. Man can no more save this planet than man can save himself. We can be responsible and we shouldn't pollute. We shouldn't put chemicals and things in our waterways. We shouldn't put chemicals and things in the ground that ought not to be there. I think everybody's responsibility is to pick up, clean up, and do things like that. But we don't worship the planet. And God has to have a sense of humor on this Earth Day to kind of cool it off a little bit. And, you know, there was so many a few years ago when Al Gore was leading the charge on climate, global warming, several global warming conventions had to be canceled due to inclement weather. Now, you tell me whether or not God has a sense of humor. And there was one crew that went up to prove that all of the polar caps and the ice at the North Pole was melting. And we got to go up there and save the polar bears. How about this? They went up there and they got snowed in. And the ice formed, it was so thick that they had to be rescued by helicopter. So much for that. I guarantee you they haven't been up there trying to at Antarctica and the Arctic and trying to prove that again. So the point I'm making is the Lord is in charge and there's no need in getting a new religion. We don't make a religion of skin color. We don't make a religion of our gender. We don't make a religion of the planet. We serve the true and living God who is large and in charge. I got a question. I want to know, and Brother Gary, perhaps you can help me with the audience out there, and maybe someone would tell me, what car or what fossil fuels were they burning? What car was they driving? How much damage did the internal combustion engine do? What role did it play? Trucks, planes, trains, and automobiles, what role did they play in ending the ice age? Because it certainly ended and the ice melted. I'll tell you what I believe. I believe when we see things going on in this world today, I believe much of what we see is the planet rejecting the sinfulness of mankind, and I believe that we are seeing the sins of men having an effect on this planet. And I also believe that we see the planet mourning and groaning for the manifestations of the sons of God, according to Romans chapter 8 and verse 18 and down. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed. For the earnest expectation of the creature, the earnest expectation of the created universe, waits for the manifestation of the sons of God. Look at the Bible. For the creature, that is creation, was made subject to vanity. It was made subject to sin. This is why we got the thorns, the thistles, the bad weather, the hurricanes, the tornadoes, because of the fall. It was made subject to vanity, but not willingly. The planet didn't want to, the universe didn't want to Adam to sin and Eve to be tricked by the devil. It says, not willingly, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same in hope. The person who subjected the created universe to all of this. Oh my. And you know, Brother Gary, I'm on an impromptu Bible study. I hadn't even planned this, but God, the Holy Spirit, he speaks to me. The Bible says this, Genesis 3 and 17, and Adam, and unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened to the voice of thy wife and hast eaten of the tree of which I command thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for thy sake. In sorrow shalt thou eat of it in all the days of thy life. Thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field. And look at this. And in the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread till thou return to the ground. For out of it wast thou taken. And God says, for dust thou art, and unto dust thou shalt return. This is what I believe is going on. The curse of mankind, the curse of because man rejected God. We see it played out in the weather. Oh, and by the way, they dropped global warming, and they dropped global cooling, because in the 70s, it wasn't global warming, it was global cooling. They said by now we'd all be frozen. So much for that. So, and they call that science. So now, a few years ago, it was global warming. So what they did was they shifted to a new slogan that that can't miss. They call it climate change. Well, everybody knows that the climate changes. So the climate has always changed, will always change, and shall always change. So the Bible teaches that, back to Romans here, that it was subjected, Romans chapter 8, read it at your leisure, verse 18 and down, and verse 21 says, because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption unto the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole created universe, the whole creature groaneth and travaileth in pain until now, unto this present time. And you know, when they say that the planet is cooling or warming, I want to know, how many years have they been studying the temperatures? How many years did we go back? You see, so if we go back 1,000 years, was it heating or cooling? If we go back 2,000, how far do we go? How do we know that some of these changes aren't just natural things? I believe it is in part natural, but due to fallen nature, due to sin. Because God says in 2 Chronicles 7 and 14, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face, God says, I will hear from heaven, forgive the sin, and heal the land. God is able, my friends, to heal the land, but we've got to turn back to the Lord, and we've got to resist the temptation of those who are trying to keep chaos going in America. You know, many people did not believe that the verdict of concerning the George Floyd case would come back with the officer being found guilty on all charges. And I believe that the system worked. But isn't it amazing that as soon as the system works, now we're saying we see politicians who say, well, that's not justice. That's accountability. OK, well, it's not justice because George Floyd will never be able to go home again. Well, that's a given. That's been true every time. You know, it was when a person gets killed, friends, they can't return home. They can't do anything. And up until now, when a guilty party was found guilty, we call that justice. Now it's no longer justice. It's called accountability. Do you know why? Because there are those, and it's not necessarily the people that we see talking, but it is the elites who try to keep whites against blacks, to divide this nation for the sake of conquering it. Chaos is a part of the plan. They do not want justice. As a matter of fact, I'll go so far to say that many of those people were disappointed with the verdict. They already had they had their kerosene, they had their stones, their bricks, they had everybody in place to just go out and pillage and destroy. Lo and behold, the jury says guilty of all charges, and all of a sudden now they can't throw any rocks. So let me tell you something. We need to pray. We need to pray to God that the Lord would keep us, that to God to bring peace. And most importantly, we need to pray to the God of the Bible that his will is done. And much of what we see today, Jesus said, and you know, this Bible is something, you know, they call it an old book and all that, but it's more current than tomorrow morning's newspaper. Jesus actually said the things that we're seeing now, that we're going to see them, but he told us not to be afraid and to look up and to get excited. So I got to wrap this up. I'm going long today, but I just want to pour into you. I love you. And I want to encourage you in the Lord. I want to tell you what your frame of mind should be. And it shouldn't be fear. It shouldn't be anger. It shouldn't be rage. Someone told me one time, this was years ago, they said, if you're a black man living in America, and if you're not angry, then you are not hip. You're not a black man of conscience. So I tried walking around being angry for a few days. Hey, that got old, and it got old fast. I decided, no, I'm going to live and enjoy Jesus and walk in the joy of the Lord. Our Lord said this, and he said in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 24, verse 6, says, and you shall hear wars and rumors of wars, and see that you be not troubled, for these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise up against nation. That is civil wars, nations, Antifa, BLM, the Klan, good people, wicked people, dividing blacks, dividing black and white, dividing people. Nation shall rise up against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There shall be famine, self-explanatory, and pestilence, COVID, and the rest of them, earthquakes in diverse places. And look at what Jesus says. All these, my friends, Jesus said, are the beginning of sorrows. Then they shall deliver you up to be afflicted and shall kill you. And you shall be hated of all nations for my sake. Then shall many be offended and shall betray one another and shall hate one another. And many false prophets shall arise and shall deceive many. You're not going to deceive me, and you're not going to deceive, you false prophets, those who are blood bought, filled with the Holy Ghost, and who go to good churches where the Bible is preached. Not anecdotal stories, not good, nice little similes and nice stories and just words of encouragement, but the word of God. They said that it shall deceive many, and because iniquity shall abound, the love of many will wax cold. You know, one of the good big examples of cold love, a man can be drowning. and people can be where they can reach and pull the man out the water. You know what most people will do now? They'll pull out the cell phone and tape it while the man's right. They don't even think to try to rescue the person. Says, we're gonna tape this. A guy attacks a lady on the street and no one comes to her rescue, but it gets taped. I'm telling you, we're living in a wicked day. But here's what's wonderful, and I got to go. I want to invite you to church tonight. Man, I'm going to tell you the truth. The word of the Lord is so powerful. It's so rich. Till Garrett, he's probably telling me, I'm not looking at him, telling me to wrap it up. Time's up. I've gone too long. But he that endureth unto the end shall be saved. Stay saved. Stay with Jesus Christ. I will be preaching tomorrow night. I will be preaching the theme because we're in our ministers and workers conference. And the theme that God gave me for our conference this year is qualified worshiping servants. The question was asked, Lord, who shall abide in thy tabernacle and who shall dwell in thy holy hill? He that have clean hands and a pure heart, who have not lifted up his soul unto vanity nor sworn deceitfully. Oh, what a conference this has been. Tonight, the woman of God, the supervisor of Greater of North Carolina Third Jurisdiction, Mother Beverly Dejeuner, will be delivering the word of the Lord. And yours truly will have greetings. But tomorrow night, I want you to take note of this. I want you to join me on this medium. Out there, you, our streamers, our friends, tomorrow night, I'm going to be delivering a word that is going to make a difference in your life. God wants all of us. He's called us to be worshiping servants, and he's given the qualifications to be in his presence. And listen to this, the qualifications for him to be in our presence. I want to be in the presence of the Lord. So join me tomorrow night. Right here. Amen. At the Upper Room Church of God in Christ, doing our fifth ministers and workers meeting for Bible study and some strong preaching. Yeah, we're going to study the word of God together, and I'm going to preach the word of God with power and authority. And when I preach, I want you to say amen. I love you. God bless you. We'll see you tonight here for the service. And remember, tomorrow night at the same time, 7:30, tomorrow night at the Upper Room Church of God in Christ. God bless.